Notice how we never said you had to be a good dancer, James?
Oh, yeah.
Good morning, everybody.
Happy morning. Wednesday. If it's good morning. It's Wednesday where you are. Ah, hello, everybody. Nice to see lots of activity in the chat already, too.
Yeah.
Everybody's up early this morning. Everybody's up, got their coffee way earlier than
That's right.
Than some of us.
Oh, look at that. We have colleagues in Ottawa hanging out with us today. Good morning, Peter.
In the snow.
Yeah, hey, Peter. There's I think Catherine, was it earlier as well, as with us? Carolyn, sorry. I can't see it right now without scrolling back up. Yep. Where it is snowing a little bit here. A gentle pre-Christmassy snow. Not quite snow globey yet. A little finer than that. But it has that air of the season to it.
Our guest this morning is James Gilchrist. He's hanging out with us. Where are you at today, James?
I'm in Jersey City, right across the river from Lower Manhattan, in the Newport waterfront area, where we've had a little bit of snow to kick off the holiday season. Fell this past weekend, but right now it's just chilly and cold. Little overcast skies where I am.
Looks like you have a fellow New Yorker in the chat this morning. What's New Paltz?
Oh, New Paltz. New Paltz is a lovely town. I don't know. I feel like it's about 50 minutes north of the city. They can write and confirm that. But it's a great little town.
That's a new one for me. Well, welcome from New Paltz, New York.
90 minutes. All right. Good to know. Hey, that's a colleague of mine. Shout out to Shari Lynn. Glad you could make it.
Awesome.
Very cool. Yeah, so our guest today is James Gilchrist. James, we'll give you a chance maybe to introduce yourself to the folks that have joined us here today, a little bit about who you are, what you do, where you've been, that kind of stuff, just to get us started.
Sure thing. I'd first like to say thanks very much to Brent and Chris for inviting me to be a part of today's podcast. I first heard about the podcast while attending the DevLearn event in Las Vegas in October, that was a great experience. And it was because of just a conversation that got started around the fact that I happen to play guitar, and I learned that these two brilliant guys also play guitar. So we immediately were able to sort of get together on that. And we talked a little bit about what I do, and that's what led to this morning. So thank you guys very much. It's a pleasure to be here. To say a little bit about myself, I at the moment, my title is Associate Director of Client Learning Programs at DTCC, which is the Depository Trust and Clearing Corporation. I do not manage a team. I am part of a great team of instructional designers, technical documentation specialists, e-learning developers, video producers. We're doing all, you know, pretty much everything you can think of in the in the learning and development space, we do. I started with DTCC back in 2008 when I was hired as a freelance instructional designer. I spent about 2 years working for them. I think I was originally hired for a 3-month contract, and I did that work, and they upped it to 6 months. Exactly, Chris. And then they upped it to a year, and then they upped it to another year. And at that point, they were like,
we might as well just keep you.
You might as well just hire you, because this is just going to keep going. So that was 2010. So I'm coming up on 10 years as working as an instructional designer, a learning architect. I think I've had like 3 or 4 different titles in the last 10 years as my responsibilities have grown. But it's a great place to work, and I've certainly learned a ton. So that's a little bit about me. Apart from folks who weren't able to hear the green room conversation happening before the podcast kicked off, I did mention that I'm a guitarist, I'm a singer-songwriter, and a longtime actor and voiceover artist as well. So that sort of rounds me out.
Mm-hmm. Our official topic today, training innovations in a heavily controlled Tell us a bit about that, the world that you work in, because that emphasis on that heavily controlled aspect, give people a sense of that kind of aspect of things.
Yeah, so DTCC for more than 45 years has served as the premier post-trade market infrastructure for the financial industry, specializing in being at the center of securities trading, processing more than 90 million financial transactions a day. We serve as a centralized clearinghouse for more than 50 exchanges and equity platforms, maintaining multiple data and operating centers worldwide. And we are highly regulated. There isn't a thing that we do that the SEC and other regulating agencies aren't involved in. And we are also regulated by the street. We are looking to improve efficiencies, lower costs, increase stability in the financial markets. So we are beholden to the clients that we serve. As you can imagine, in that kind of environment, and often with so many, it's financial, right? So you all those transactions are resulting in money passing back and forth, trade settling, balancing, et cetera. It's important, you know, you can't make a mistake, basically. And so anytime we want to initiate a new service or create a new platform or begin a modernization effort of an existing platform, because I said 45 years, we've been doing this since it was all paper, you know, and we're constantly trying to keep up with and lead the way in some cases as we are processing these securities. We have to make sure that we're looping in the SEC, getting buy-in from clients, and definitely crossing our T's and dotting all of our I's.
That's why it was so great when we were chatting, and I knew this was going to be the topic, and it had to be, because and you had to be the person to talk with us about it. Well, mostly because you play guitar too, but
mostly, yeah.
If anybody's going to talk about a highly controlled environment and how we can be effective in that space, boy, that environment, you can't get much more highly controlled than that.
Anybody, it's locked down.
Yeah. Anybody else in the chat? Yeah. You know, besides James' colleagues that have joined us in the chat, how about the rest of you? Do you feel like you're working in a controlled environment, or why don't you just drop it into the chat while we, continue the conversation here. Let us know how you guys deal with a controlled environment. James and I were telling Chris earlier. James and I jumped on, and we encountered one of the first things that you will all discover when you start to work in a controlled environment is the firewall issue and what content can come through and what content can't come through. But James and I worked all that out yesterday, but it makes for a perfect start to the details of this conversation, I think, because it's something we all have to deal with, right?
Yeah, I would. I'll say that it was great. First of all, Brent, that you were willing to spend not one 15-minute block, but two separate 15-minute blocks where we ironed out all the details and made sure that I was going to be able to be seen and heard on today's show. So kudos. Thank you. Appreciate that. The difficulty stems from complexity, right? Security, first and foremost, and complexity. And I would just say, if you are someone who's working, maybe you're not working in finance, but you're working in a large corporate structure. If you're not your own sort of in-house learning group, but are part of a much larger organization, there's always going to be navigating going on to get all the parties that need to be involved when it comes to connectivity or, you know, supporting the kinds of high-end learning solutions you want to deliver. Like video, for example, this is a great example. Here we are, we're doing a podcast and we're streaming live video. And maybe you aren't doing that in your learning organization, but it's something you want to do more of. You have to have the bandwidth. You have to have the pipes. You've got to have a connection that isn't clogged, you know, with emails going back and forth, right? Because then, you know, your clients are going to get a poor experience. But it's really just about communication, understanding the moving parts, who's involved, and actually reaching out to people. I feel like there's too many instances where it's the lack of communication that are resulting in the block. And sometimes you just got to get up from your desk and go to the 10th floor and have a conversation with somebody and, you know, put a human face on whatever it is the issue is. Mm-hmm. Turning away from that and talking more about creating learning content in a controlled environment, one of the things that Brent and I talked about on the expo hall floor at DevLearn was the need to loop in parties that might not be the easiest to bring to the table and explain the end goal as a learning solutions provider to, like, say, legal. Okay, so if you have a legal department, and in our company, of course, we have a huge legal department, and they're responsible for putting out rule filings, important notices, and all the language has to be vetted, you know, multiple times before it goes out to the street. And I think in the description for today's podcast, Brent talked about jargon, right? Legalese and jargon, and how do you get around that? And in reality, if you work in a controlled environment, you are beholden to making sure that you are aligning with all of those requirements first and foremost. Then the challenge becomes, how do you take that information and turn it into something that will be consumed, right? And I think establishing good relationships with the people within your organization that are either they're holding the purse strings, or they're in charge of the firewall, or they're, you know, responsible for putting out legal documentation, you have to bring them in. You have to bring them in and spend time explaining to them, hey, you know, you spent all this time creating these rules, and it's so important that the street, as an example, understands them. Because if they don't, there are consequences, financial penalties, errors, delays, that sort of thing. But it's not enough to create something that only the lawyers working at those firms understand, you know, because frankly, their job is to write stuff just like you, you know, and put that out for their clients. But they aren't the ones that are manning the phones or monitoring the systems or taking calls from clients and helping them with their transactions, right? So at some point, it's got to get distilled down into a format that is concise, on point, easy to access, and solves a problem. So I had a great experience earlier this year where I had to take a concept, a topic that is extremely dense, and it deals with what happens if a member were to default. Okay, so you say that and you immediately go, so there's some big consequences there. The good news is that it almost never happens. This isn't something that it's not happening all the time. It's never happening. But yet, if something were to upset the balance, just look back at 2008 and other events that, you know, stuff can happen. Yeah. It's so important that people know what to do, right? Think of the airline attendants telling you how to exit the plane in the case of an emergency. It's not like, you know, that stuff at a basic level, we all get and understand. And it's life and death. You really do need to know it. Something that can affect trillions of, you know, transactions on a day in 2008, if things start to go sideways, you don't want people having to crowd into their lawyer's office and ask them what to do, right? You've got to give them the information they need to respond quickly and make sure they're doing everything they can to ensure the situation is handled as efficiently as possible. So I was working with someone in legal who was trying to explain to me what to do, or what FICC's, the Fixed Income Clearing Corporation, which is a subsidiary of DTCC, what they're responsible for in the case of this type of situation. And we spent hours of time on the phone looking paragraph by paragraph by paragraph, saying, okay, I think I understand this. And I'll use her name because she's an amazing person, Rosa Chang. She was great to work with. Rosa, I think I understand what this means, but we can't say it that way because no one will watch this. You know, no one will stay on. No one's going to know this information. We have to give them some kind of a real world example. We have to give them some kind of visual aid that's going to drive the point home. We need a flow that you can understand, and a timeline of the events that take place in real time, you know, And we can't be constantly referring back to, you know, section 4.2 in the code of X, Y, and Z. And after a while, she got that, you know, and she became a great partner and really made sure that we were able to not only create a solution that provided the correct and accurate info, but also did it in a way that suddenly people were watching, you know. So I'm confident now looking at the hits, knowing at the video views, et cetera. Like, I know people are getting the information and they're even rating it on our website. So saying that that it's a good solution. So it's diligence, it's relationship building, it's understanding. You got to put yourself in the mindset of the person who's got the information you need. Any subject matter expert, they have their job. It's your job to insert yourself into their world and bridge the gap, you know?
Yeah. It's interesting, just even when you first mentioned talking to the legal department, et cetera, what popped into my mind was the in eLearning and the Science of Instruction, Dr. Ruth Colvin Clark and Richard Mayer, they're ongoing. I'm not going to call it a series, but I think they're into the fourth edition now. One of the earliest editions, and it's carried all the way through, is a recognition that informal language in multimedia is much more engaging and leads to better results than formal language.
Right.
But as soon as you hear the phrase legal team, mm-hmm. you sort yep. of go like. But so, you know, even just finding the balance of making it not just understandable, but also something that people can feel a little more connected to is.
Right.
That's a huge challenge, and it's obviously not going to be something that you can accomplish without buy-in from the legal team, who still have to sign off on it. And we've seen some projects right. where, no, there has to be phrased exactly, you know, like this because of legal ramifications, etc. So yeah. On the technology side, we had a client team once that was financial industry, but really spread out, and they kept telling us. Because, you know, being a web-based authoring tool, no, we have a giant pipe coming into to our offices, and then it took like months, like 3-4 maybe even 6 months to finally determine that the nature of that technology structure was that it prioritized their core business, which right. I mean, only makes sense, and any other use, including simply, you know, browser-based use, was put down at the very lowest level of priority, which
right.
up until they started using a web-based tool, was not something that was, you know, part of the recognition of its value. It was more like, oh, you're doing a Google search. Well, we'll put that down at the lowest level because we got to make sure that the transaction level stuff is always going. So, you know, no matter how many times we kept doing, you know, tests and stuff, it took months anyway to finally get that recognized that was, you know, that there was a change in policy that was required in order for this endeavor to actually be successful. So,
and people ask me, people will come up to me and they'll ask me a question about a particular issue that they're having. And I might have experience dealing with that particular issue, but I am often coming at them with questions that deal with what, give me the big picture. Like what are all the moving parts? Who have you talked to? Who have you involved? What kind of solution are you looking to come up with? I think I saw this on a slide at one of the keynote speakers at DevLearn, where we were looking at a list of the accepted roles and responsibilities. I'm like, I've got my hand in the air, but you can't see it. The accepted roles and responsibilities of the learning specialist, right, over time. And it has exploded, you know, because our jobs, if you are supporting a single product and you're sort of working in a marketing learning capacity, that's great. But in a complex organization with so many different products and services and moving parts, you are basically, it's on you to figure out how you can share with all of those stakeholders the role that learning plays and potentially plays in connecting with their clients. So it's usually not one answer. You know, you come up with an ideal solution, then you have to bring it to all the different stakeholders and you have to talk their language. You know, you have to understand what their needs are, what their problems are, what their obstacles are, you know, what their budget is. And you have to be able to make a case and talk to them not as a learning developer, but as a colleague in the company that is aligned and trying to accomplish the same thing that they are, You know?
Yeah, you have to gain their respect and let them know that you respect the same things they do, which is oftentimes when I talk to folks that work in environments like yours, instead of fighting it, because I think what I see in a lot of the communities that I'm in and a lot of the other industry professionals, it's, you know, we need to be stronger and we need to push back and we need to get these better solutions in there. And I'm always a bit hesitant to be that strong because of the experiences I've had like yours in those. There's always reasons why we can't do things, and they're always good reasons. So instead, I always like to just kind of steer the conversation around, why don't we take all of these constraints and call them guideposts and embrace them and figure out how can we be creative inside of those constraints, right?
Right.
People give you jargon. And so it's like, okay, what can we do to be creative with this jargon they've made?
Right.
You know, how can we just, you know, lighten it up a little bit, or, you know, use some good words. The jargon is still there, maybe, if it's necessary, but just things like that. Just think differently about the problem and embrace those constraints and controls instead of trying to break them and push back.
Mm-hmm. That's a great segue, Brent, to something I was hoping I would remember to talk about this morning. So I'm going to jump in and say the conversation, right? You talk about having the conversations and getting buy-in. Well, how do you do that? That's what people want to know. They're like, oh, I'm in that same situation and I don't know how to solve this problem. What do I do? One very specific tip that I would provide based on my own personal experience is that it's important to show your stakeholders that you have tried to understand their business and what their clients' needs are and what their needs are. And you can't count on getting all the information from them, okay? It's like you can't go up to somebody and say, I want you to explain the alphabet to me, and then go back to them and say, because I understand the alphabet, you should work with me. You know, it's like there's give and take, right? So you have to be able to bring some knowledge of their situation to the table to start with. The second thing is that you have to remember the analysis piece at the beginning. You have to spend some time sitting down with them and finding out what the real need is that you are trying to solve. If they haven't come to you, or maybe especially if they've come to you and said, I want you to create X, you have to walk them back and politely get to the point where you understand why they think X is the right solution, right? But then if you see an opportunity and engaging effective learning content is content that people want to watch or read or access, right? They want to, because it is the best solution that can solve their problem in the least amount of time that they would have invented themselves if they had the time to do that, right? That's always the goal. You want uptake, okay? So if you understand that there's a way to ensure that the clients are going to take up the information you create, but it will require that you be more engaging and go outside the box and be a little innovative and really get their attention in ways that, you know, in the past, a product group might not necessarily have thought to do. You can't just tell them that. That's not going to be enough. Saying to them, I have the right answer, isn't going to get the buy-in. So what I have done, and this is my tip, is to take it upon yourself to produce a solution in a vacuum and show them something that is more than a storyboard, something that actually carries with it the impact that the customer who watches it or accesses it is going to get when they see it. And once they understand, because they look at it and they say, oh, well, yeah, that's the kind of stuff that I watch, you know, or if I go on YouTube, I do this, or if I need to learn something, I take this course. If they see that you are able to take their content and make it that engaging, now suddenly they're curious. Now they are interested in, now they want to be able to say, hey, you know, working with learning, we created this lovely thing for our clients and they are watching it or they are downloading it by the hundreds, you know. So don't be afraid to go out on a limb. You might have to work outside your normal responsibilities. You may have to put more work in up front to give them that shiny car that they can get in and take for a test drive before you start to get trust, before you start to get buy-in. And then your another tip I would say is make sure that you are able to provide hard data when it comes to the value add to the client. So when they do give you carte blanche, or they at least give you a little leeway and say, okay, go ahead, try making this thing. We'll see how it works out. We'll see if our customers watch it. You have to have the mechanisms in place to be able to say to your stakeholders, I can show you exactly how many people are accessing this, or I can give you a measurement of the engagement. And hopefully you're able to tie that back to a change in behavior. You know, fewer calls to a customer helpline, fewer issues where transactions are going not as they should, more people using the reporting services that we're making available to them. Does that make sense?
Yeah, totally. I mean, talking the language of data that makes people, I mean, that they understand, and obviously proving the value to the organization. And that's core to what we're supposed to do, no matter whether we're in a controlled and regulatory environment. Right. But when you're trying to, you know, maybe move goalposts, et cetera, that kind of info can at least sometimes move people's mindsets too. Jill has a great question in the question panel. She's asking, do you find it's hard to get buy-in on the more creative solutions when a regulatory environment makes it hard to have a quicker speed to market? So, you know, trying to get creative, et cetera, but sort of maybe the slower pace because of the regulatory hurdles and constraints, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. So two things come up for me. One, when I think of a longer time to market because of regulatory constraints, you could choose to look at that as now you have more time to spend working on the solution, right? Someone I think in the chat said, people expect you to be able to spit out these high-end solutions, you know, turn it around on a dime, you know, spit it out in 10 minutes. And that's where managing expectations comes into play. And you have to be willing not to always want to produce the learning solution that's going to take the most time and energy and money to create. If there is an alternate way to present the information or solve the business issue, right? Because really that's what you're trying to do. You're right. Solving a business issue, okay? And regardless of what you can do with the splashy solution, if there's a way you can solve that business issue faster for less money and get it in the hands of the clients more effectively, efficiently, rapidly, then you are pushing the boulder uphill if you insist on doing the former, okay? So when it comes to, like, just take the technical documentation as an example. We have a learning website. It's the fundamental way that we are able to reach our clients. There's a registration they have to complete if they want to get access to our more confidential materials. But in a sense, it's just a website where we put everything we want our clients to know. And I'll have someone come to me and say, we created a document years ago that provides our clients with this particular information. The information has changed and we're now in committee and we're trying to get this entire document updated, but it's taking forever, right? It can take a long time to update comprehensive technical documentation. Yeah. So I will suggest to them, you know, if in this entire 200-page document, there's probably 10 pages that are the highlights, right? That's the information that they're going to need on a daily basis. And if they don't know it, there could be a problem. Let's take that information. Let's update that first. And let's put it in an article format, like on the website itself, just a web text on a web page. And as we pop up these pages, we'll notify folks that it's available. So now they're looking for it. They're coming back. So they're getting benefit right away. And while you're solving that business issue with those 10 articles, you have more time to finalize the comprehensive guide that will then be the Bible that they can download from now on. So you got to be flexible. You know, you can't be locked into one type of solution just because, hey, it's what you like to do. You know,
you're speaking my language, man. That iterative type of development is exactly what I try to get people engaged with. And I think part of what you're saying, too, is the idea that I think we as professionals sometimes get a little bit of, somebody called it the other day, and I love this phrase, expertitis. We get this disease where we think we know all of the answers, and we think we know that the answer that that we want to push is the right and only one. And it is much more effective, I've found, if you focus on that piece, that data piece that you were talking about. And I'm so glad you brought that up, because that's always a hot topic around here, is if you've got that data, I think we'll be surprised every now and then if you just go ahead and do what your stakeholders are asking you to do, whether you want to do it or not, but you have that data. There are those moments where that data comes back and it's like, you know what? What they asked me to do actually does work, and people are right. looking at it and they are reading it, and I was wrong. I think we need to be open to that, right? We need to be open to the fact that we might not always be right in our instructional design solutions.
That's a great point. And the first thing that popped into my head when you said expertitis is my own reaction when I have a conversation with a colleague, a stakeholder, or someone in my own department, and they come up to me and they say, oh, you're the video guy, or you're the e-learning guy, or, you know, you name it, fill in the blank. I bristle. I have this inward cringe where I think, oh no, I have somehow conveyed the information that the solutions that I provide are aligned with a format, you know? And it's great if the recognition means that if they know they want to produce that thing, they'll come to me. But I never want anyone to think, when I start a conversation with them, how can I help you help your clients? Tell me about the pain points. What do you think is going to be the most pertinent information that your clients start, you know, ingesting? And they think that I'm going to push a video on them, or they think that I'm going to insist on an e-learning solution. Sometimes they'll even start talking about that, you know, and I have to walk them back. So it's a reputational thing that I try very hard to manage, you know, because it's those preconceived notions and misapprehensions and unknown expectations that can get in the way from the get-go, you know.
Well, you probably nailed it with a really cool video at one point. And so that's
right.
Hey, he's the guy that did that really cool video that one time.
It's a double-edged sword, to be sure. You know, it's like I say, it's great to get credit, but at the same time, you know, I tend to be a macro person, right? So I'm always thinking of the big picture and trying to bring that focus to bear. And sometimes those assumptions can get in the way, you know.
Yeah, we have a toolbox, but often we're known for one particular tool set.
Right.
That, hey, it's the wrench guy. Well, right. I've got hammers. I've got There's all kinds of other things. What's your problem?
Well,
it's a screw. We'll leave the hammer in the toolbox now.
Right.
Yeah. Very cool.
Any other questions in the chat that I can speak to? I've been looking down occasionally, but I know you guys have more of an eye for that
question panel. I did want to point out a couple of things, and I'm scrolling back. Really cool. Janet, who I think has mentioned that she had to depart, but she had mentioned anecdotally earlier that we once built an ethics and compliance training that had a pirate theme. We were able to convince legal, IT, etc., that it was more important for people to be able to find what they needed when they needed it, and an e-learning would never teach them the exact terminology. Using a treasure map to teach them how to find what they needed was fun, well received, and met all the legal needs. And I can only imagine
what that looked like.
The whole set of, well, not just how it looked like, but how, you know, the whole process of getting that kind of, you know, reaching that point of agreement.
Oh,
That must have been very hard.
that's an awesome example. And then she did follow it up as well with a note. You know, we couldn't move to a fun/creative solution until we became a trusted advisor,
right.
Which I think you know, it takes us right back to the, you know, the idea of getting out of your office, connecting, you know, with people, and then being able to demonstrate, you know, values and values, both aspects, but being able to talk also as well as a language that you know, isn't thou shalt, but hey, let's, you know.
Yeah. So that's another great segue to an approach that you can take if you are trying to build those relationships, okay? If someone has been entrenched in and maybe managing an area for quite some time, their experience has taught them that what they know and how they do things is effective, and they've been rewarded. They've raised up through the mm-hmm. ranks, and so they are attached to a certain way of doing things for good reason. It can sometimes help to look around in a department and find someone who maybe isn't quite so high up the totem pole, and just spitball some ideas with them. And you may discover that they themselves have felt a little confined, a little constrained. Maybe they're the ones dealing directly with their clients, and they want to just start creating a solution, but they aren't empowered to do so. That's a great opportunity to now you can go to the manager of that department and say, listen, I've been talking with this person and we think we could do some things a little bit differently that you might like. And there's a way in, right?
Yeah.
So look at the corporate structure if you're in a corporation, but just always be thinking of the human, you know, be thinking of the person and their attitudes and find a way to, you know, to bring something to their attention that they might be more receptive to in that way. That's a good approach. The other thing is, try to work with as many different areas as possible for the specific reason of identifying champions, okay? Because even in a regulated environment, there are always going to be individuals with vision. You know, there's always going to be people that are interested in new things and wanting to break ground and advance, you know, the best solutions to the clients. And if you can get them to agree on a powerful, outside of the box, really innovative solution, in addition to helping their clients, now you can use that as a showpiece, and you can shop it around to other areas. You can say, look, we had a 685% uptick in engagement after we announced the release of this solution for this department over here. Are you guys maybe interested in some of that action? You know, like, does that sound appealing to you? And so you can sort of, you know, you seed, you plant seeds and you lay the groundwork and you try to get people coming to you for a solution that maybe a year ago you couldn't have sold them with, you know, if you had a bridge to throw in with the deal. So
yeah, I try to tell people that they need to just experiment with the low hanging fruit, like the stuff that doesn't have a lot of risk associated with it. Pick a topic mm-hmm. or pick a course that's just, you know, short, easy, something you can do on the side, and do something really super creative with it. And like you said, use it as a showcase, right? And say, mm-hmm. you know what, we can do this kind of stuff with the other things as well. This is why it was more effective than the original one, right? And you have to be able to show people and give, and I think, you know,
it show, don't tell. Put
in extra work, right? And I think that's the part that people get. I think that's one of the big roadblocks. I got to say it. And with some of the people that I've talked to, and it's like, well, I don't want to do it unless I know they're going to allow me to do it. And sometimes you do have to just kind of commit and say, you know what, I'm going to spend a weekend or two on my own.
Right.
And I'm going to work on this project and I'm going to make something really cool in the hopes that they'll look at that and go, wow, you should do more of that.
Yeah. Go ahead, Chris.
I was going to say a lot of times too, though, it's not, you don't even have to be making it yourself. You can be looking for examples that other people have, you know, created too. And so maybe you use that as a springboard to, you know, present it or recontextualize something, et cetera, as well, because, you know, Lord knows there's lots of examples of things, but it comes back down to that being able to give people a vision of an end thing so that you can get their buy-in to start down the path. As opposed to saying, no, I swear to goodness, this is totally going to be great. Totally going to be great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you know what? We're getting close to that that time of the conversation, but I want to throw
it flew by
the chat really quick. Yeah, time does fly. And just say, if there are more questions around these types of things, controlled environments and whatnot. This is the first time we've ever actually approached this conversation here on Idiotic with the community. And I'd be really curious to know if there is a lot of interest in doing this. And then we can obviously do a lot more of it. And we can have James back on And, you know, we can extend the conversation because obviously 30, 45 minutes doesn't really cover the whole thing.
Scratching the surface, right?
We touch a little bits of different things, but yeah.
I'd also like to say in the description, my bio, my picture and my link in my bio on the page for this podcast goes to my LinkedIn page. And one of my favorite things to do is to just troubleshoot, problem solve, and listen to people who are trying to solve problems, solve business issues, learning solutions. So I would recommend and invite anyone on this call and anyone you know you think might be interested or is struggling with an issue and maybe just wants a sounding board, connect with me on LinkedIn. Let me know and let me know that you heard the Idiotic Podcast. And that would be, I would love to help. It basically is what it boils down to. That's what I love to do.
Yeah.
And I tossed that link into the chat there for anybody who is interested in that, so they can connect with you on that front as well too, for sure. Very cool. Oh, this has been we've touched a lot of things. And even though we've been talking about the context of a heavily controlled environment, so much of what we've talked about too just applies to all of us, whether we're in that, you know, that specific, whether we're in that box or not. Right. So many things about relationships, about listening, talking, sharing, connecting, networking, so many valuable points in all of that. So James, thanks so much for joining us here today. We've given out the info on how people can connect with you, and folks do that if you are interested or if you're looking at something, you're trying to figure out how to get there, give them a note on LinkedIn there. So cool.
Thank you, Chris. And thank you, Brent. And thank you for everyone who dialed in. Appreciate
it. Yeah, our pleasure. Thanks for joining us today. Hey, gang, happy Wednesday, and let's all dance.
Let's do it. Good to see you all. I'm doing the new special rotation effect.
Ooh.
I just invented that.
Brent just invented the lazy Susan. All right. Have a great day, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Adios.